Thank you very much. And good morning, everybody, or good evening for those who are participating from the United States. I'm very much, I'm very pleased to introduce this special session presented by COLCON, which is the cultural and educational interchange between the United States and Japan, which is one of the oldest, I believe, organizations that have been set up to deepen cultural as well as educational understanding between the United States and Japan, which was set up in 1961. Since I see Ito-san on the screen, I would just like to briefly thank her in particular this time, because I approached her if she would be if COLCON would be interested in sponsoring this AAS event. Mm. And then it so fortuitously happened that COLCON was about to close two subcommittee groups, one on arts education and curation and the other one on student mobility. And so we will be the, so she sort of offered the idea of presenting the reports for these two committees. So I believe that we are very much privileged to be the first to hear any public hearings, I think, about these reports. So I thank you very much. We have to thank you for the fact that for most of our sponsors, they have endured the COVID situation whereby there was no physical roundtable or anything to sponsor. So I'm doubly grateful for that. Thank you very much. And I'm just going to briefly go through the order of, as I understand, the speakers today. Mm-hmm. We will have Professor Kubo from Tokyo University. Good morning, sir. He is an eminent professor on American studies at Tokyo University. And I believe he's the Japanese chair of COLCON. Excuse me. Then it will be followed by Professor Masako Egawa from Hitotsubashi University.
Order is an anchor is, first. Yes.
Okay. Yes. Excuse me then. there are four participants. Professor Masako Egawa from Hitotsubashi University, who will be speaking about student mobility, correct? Mm-hmm. And then we will have Professor Dr. Anne Nishimura Moore from the Boston Museum of Arts, who will be talking about the arts and cultural sort of curation report part, correct? Mm-hmm. Yes. Which I think follows very nicely from yesterday's conversation with Dr. Mino from the Hyogo Museum of Arts. Mm-hmm. And then finally, we will be joined by Dr. Sheila Smith, mm-hmm. who I believe will be joining later. I presume mm-hmm. she's very busy with all the interviews about Prime Minister Abe's resignation.
Nobody expected that.
Sheila Smith, of course, and for most all the panelists today, are in many ways the key people who are the sort of the cornerstone, the stability of US-Japan relations. So we're very much honored today to have all of you present despite the early hours or the late hours. So without further ado, I would like to hand over the microphone to Professor Kubo. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Ito-san, would you say something?
Okay. Well, first of all, thank you very much, Professor Sato Haruko-san, for organizing this wonderful session. And what a surprise that we had the tiger bomb on the head of the head, just before this wonderful session for meditation. So it gives us some relief that, you know, from the morning stress. But anyway, we would like to accept to receive lots of, you know, questions and comments from the audience. For the first Professor Kubo's presentation, we will take the questions, but then he will answer together with Dr. Sheila Smith later. So, but please keep on, you know, posting your questions and comments on the chat page. Thank you very much. And without further ado, please welcome Dr. Kubo. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello, everyone. Good morning and good evening. I'm Fumiya Kubo, Vice Chair of Japan Panel of COLCON. What I'd like to do at this session is first to explain what the COLCON is and then what it has been and it is trying to do. I guess COLCON is not particularly famous. It stands for the United States-Japan Conference on Cultural and Educational Interchange. It is a bi-national advisory panel whose membership consists of Americans as well as Japanese. On both sides, the panel has not just government officials, but also private citizens like me, which might be pretty unique. This is a mission statement. Its purpose is written at the bottom part of the slide with the underline. The three pillars are cultural interchange, exchange, educational exchange, and intellectual exchange. COLCON was, as Professor Sato said, established in 1961 at the summit meeting of Prime Minister Ikeda and the Prime Minister, President Kennedy. In 1960, this is a little bit about the background for the COLCON. US-Japan Security Treaty was successfully revised in 1960. However, as you know, there were strong negative reaction to that, as well as the way it was decided in Japan. There's a huge protest movement in Tokyo, which made it impossible for the US government, as well as Japanese government, to carry out the planned visit to Tokyo by President Eisenhower. It was a shocking incident, especially to the United States. That year, Professor Edwin Reischer, professor at Harvard University of Japanese History, published an article entitled Broken Dialogue with Japan. I think this is a background for President Kennedy and Prime Minister Ikeda to establish COLCON. I guess it was basically a US initiative that brought about COLCON at that time. There was a sense in the United States in 1960 that even though Japan was an ally of the United States did not know enough about Japan, and that the United States must gain a much deeper understanding of Japanese culture, history, customs, society, and probably people. Which is also true with the Japan side. The people didn't know each other at that time. I think this has a sense at that time. When you look at some documents regarding the COLCON meetings of early days in 1960s, you will find some high profile names among, particularly among US participants, such as Arthur Schlesinger Jr., a special assistant to the President Kennedy, and Hugh Morton, the president of Harvard University. It is a witness that the US side thought that COLCON was very important. Now a little bit more on COLCON. Qualcomm does not have its own bureaucracy to implement its recommendation. It has just a small secretariat, which is now housed in the Japan Foundation. It does not have a big budget, unfortunately, either. It identifies problems or opportunities in expanding the cultural or educational exchanges and issues recommendation. But it has good access to government because first high-ranking officials from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Education in the case of Japan and those from the Department of State and Education are regular members of the panel. And second, from time to time, Qualcomm's recommendation was brought to the Prime Minister and the President. This is the current the members, and these are ex-officio government members. At one time, actually, the one joint statement at the summit meeting between Prime Minister Abe and the President Obama mentioned the Qualcomm recommendation and adopted as a part of the joint statement as the common goal of the two governments, which is to double the number of the American students studying in Japan and that of the Japanese students studying in the United States. And also Qualcomm got reactivated since 2007 and 8 under the leadership of Mr. Makihara and Porti, and Ambassador Kato and Mr. Hill are their recent and the current chairs. I heard that just before 2007, there's a talk in private about even abolishing Qualcomm. And you could make a somewhat good case for that. You know, cultural exchanges between Japan and the United States these days are far richer than they used to be in early 1960s. And cultural exchanges between the United States and Japan became richer and deeper, mostly without government intervention. There's an interesting book about Japan's public diplomacy, actually written by a Chinese scholar from 1952 to 72, in which the author touched upon Qualcomm by going through the original documents. It is of extreme interest to know that at that time, I mean early 1960s, panelists from Japan side complained again and again and again about the unequal nature of cultural exchanges. In 1960s, American culture penetrated into Japan a lot, while Japanese culture was introduced or known to the Americans only in a limited way. So there's a sea change between 1960s and early 21st century. But this does not mean that the mutual understanding of each other is enough, sufficient. As I suggested at the outset, Americans were wondering if they understood Japan enough in 1960, faced with the anti-American protest, although we were in alliance. In 2009, there was a new non-LDP government in Japan whose policy toward the United States was different from that of the previous government. For example, in 2009, the foreign minister advocated the East Asian community excluding the United States explicitly. Americans wondered again, what is happening in Japan, still an important ally for the United States. Then it was Japan's turn to wonder what is going on in the United States after the election of 2016. These are just a few easy to understand examples of why we still need Qualcomm. And you know, these are some of the pictures taken from the recent activities. And cultural and educational exchanges were two pillars of the mission of Qualcomm since its foundation. But in 2007, a new mission was added, which was the intellectual exchange, which I believe is a really important addition to the activities of Qualcomm. Qualcomm is now able to deal with the exchanges by public intellectuals or think tanks. So this is just a short history of Qualcomm. I hope I was able to give you some sense about what it is. I will add a few words later if we have some extra time. I stop here now. And you know, this last slide shows some of the forecast activities of the current Qualcomm, and the explanation of them follow in a moment. Please enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Kubo, for your very profound explanation how Qualcomm started with you know, the profound perspectives at the time of the creation. And thank you very much. And for the audiences, please keep on writing your comments and questions on the chat page. Later, we will, Professor Kubo and Dr. Smith will jointly answer to your questions and the queries. So without further ado, we would like to move on to our next presenter, Dr. Ann Nishimura-Moss. She is a senior curator of the Japanese art at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. So Ann, thank you very much. And she was one of the most long-serving panelists for Qualcomm, and she co-chaired this Arts Dialogue Committee, so, which is one of the very successful committees ever that the Qualcomm had. So thank you very much for your participation from Boston, and Dr. Amos Nishimura-Moss, thank you.
Let's see, good evening. I'm actually not in Boston tonight. I'm in Maine, in northern New England. And it's a year ago, if you were to say that I would be able to do a conference sitting here in Maine, I would not have believed it. But that is the nature of where we are. I have not been at the museum since March 12th. We have all still been in quarantine. And in fact, my museum is still not open. So much in flux here. But I'm very pleased to be able to talk about the work of the Arts Dialogue Committee. It is a committee that started in 2010, and it was organized originally by on the US side by Willard Clark, and on the Japanese side by Dr. Sato Teiichi, who was then succeeded by Aoyagi Masanori, as well as Shimatani Hiroyuki. And I have been the co-chair on the US side since 2011. And I have just retired as a panelist for Qualcomm, but so it's great to be able to review the work that we did during this time period. The Arts Dialogue Committee was established to examine obstacles to artistic exchange between Japan and the United States, and to explore new areas of collaboration. It has committee members. It had committee members from leading museums, universities, and foundations, both the US and Japanese sides. Qualcomm, as you know, can you see my screen? Yes. Qualcomm, as you know, has two pillars to it, as Dr. Kubo has just mentioned: cultural and educational interchange, as well as now intellectual exchanges. But for the Japanese and US bilateral relationship, art has always served as an effective ambassador for Japan. During the 1960s and 1970s, Japan announced its revitalization through major international events, such as the 1964 Tokyo Olympics and Expo 70 in Osaka. Although the 10 years preceding the 1964 Olympics, there had been only 13 exhibitions of Japanese art in museums throughout the United States, a situation that Dr. Kubo had just mentioned, 10 years after these events, there were over 41 exhibitions in the United States. Similarly, during this period, during the late 1960s and 1970s, there were numerous students who were drawn to careers as professionals in Japanese art. They were interested in things such as Zen, woodblock prints, and Edo period painting. Today, we all know that young students are very interested in manga and anime. And while we were working on this committee with the announcement of the 2020 Olympics, we thought that this would be a good opportunity to assess the state of museums in the United States who were special, you know, had interest in presenting Japanese art, to see what American audiences, how they were responding to Japanese art, and to see whether or not we could re-engage the public about the power and importance of Japanese art of all types, not just manga and anime. One of the first things we did in 2013 was to just review who was presenting Japanese art in the United States, who were the museum specialists. And one of the first things that we found, which was actually quite alarming, was the number of specialists who had come aboard in the late 1960s and early 70s, and they've loved what they've been doing. They've been very invested and very effective in presenting it. But all of a sudden, we're looking at it and we realize of the 21 Japanese specialists working in 2013, 76% were going to be eligible for retirement by 2020. And that was a wake-up call. How do we ensure that there would not be a decline in numbers of Japanese art specialists? And how could we launch a new generation of potential curators? And so we started putting together programs. We had already begun meeting, and one of the first programs that everyone had thought had been very effective for many years had been this program, the International Workshop on Japanese Art History for graduate students, which has been affectionately known and more commonly known as JAWS. JAWS had been launched in 1987 and had had more than 200 students who had engaged in graduate programs. Sorry for the telephone call. It's what happens in Zoom calls. But there had been over 200 graduates of this program, and they had become leaders in universities and in museums, and they had really established a network. And so one of the first programs that the Arts Dialogue Committee wanted to reinstate was this JAWS program, which had been suspended for over 6 years for lack of funding. So the first session, which was funded by foundations in Japan as well as private collectors in the United States, convened in 2012 at the University, Tokyo University of the Arts, with over 25 students participating from universities in the United States, Europe, Australia, and Japan. And the typical JAWS program is usually a week-long program where students present lectures to each other and then participate in workshops and excursions. This was very effective, and so another one was held in 2017 at Harvard University and the Museum of Fine Arts Boston. And again, bringing students from the United States, Japan, and Europe together, they did various things besides giving papers on their own specialty to each other. They also went to visit collectors in New York. But I guess one of the most memorable things, and I think Ito-san will remember this, there was a huge snowstorm in Boston and everything came to a screeching halt. And you might have thought that that was a disaster, but in fact, it was a very good bonding experience for all of those students. And I don't think any of them will forget where they were March 2017. It's something that I think throughout their careers, they will have in common. Another session of JAWS was originally scheduled for 2020. It was to be held in Japan, but due to the Olympics first and then concerns about accommodations in Japan during the time, but also now due to the pandemic, that JAWS session has been postponed, but we hope that it will be convened shortly. Not only is getting the next generation started, not only do we need to support graduate students, but as they move along, we also need to help them with entry-level positions. With all of these curators in their 60s and 70s, it was going to be very difficult for young curators to move in. And so one of the first things that was done is the Japan Foundation in 2016 established a program called US and European Museum Infrastructure and Support Program, which provided three positions in the United States, three five-year positions at the Freer Portland Art Museum and Asian Art Museum to enhance the staff, to expand the staff. And similarly, the Ishibashi Foundation in 2018 established 5 2-year positions whereby beginning curators could receive mentorship from senior curators and thereby learn the ropes on the job in that way. The Arts Dialogue Committee was very conscious of creating a sort of a tiered approach so that we were not only making sure that graduate students, young and young professionals were being taken care of, but emerging scholars of all sorts and giving them platforms for it. And so the Japan Information and Culture Center has initiated a program, a quarterly program, whereby they put the spotlight on an emerging scholar. It allowed the scholar to present his or her ideas to the public, and it allowed the public to hear about topics they may otherwise hear about otherwise. It's really important, particularly for museum professionals, to present to the public, because graduate students are so used to public to present to specialists, to present to each other, but presenting to a public audience is a very, very difficult sometimes task for them to do, and this is a very supportive environment in which for them to do so. As curators move along, it's also really necessary that they get to know the community of curators, and the Tokyo National Museum in 2014 launched the Curatorial Exchange with support from the Agency for Cultural Affairs. It has now had been held over six different years with curators coming from all over, from Europe and the United States and Japan. One was held just before the pandemic hit at the beginning of February. It was the sixth such session. It addressed topics, and we often look at topics that provide new perspectives on our field, summon all of us together for discussion so that we can help support each other. Often, many of us are the only ones in our field and in an institution, so there is no greater joy than being able to talk to specialists in our field and compare notes. So the sixth session in Tokyo was on creating diverse narratives in the Arts of Japan and museum exhibitions, and had speakers from the National Museum of Ethnology in Japan, as well as the Freer Sackler Museum, Honolulu Museum of Art, the Rietberg in Zurich, and the Tokyo National Museum, with over almost 50 participants in this particular program. And every year, as I said, the specialists get together to talk about issues of professional concerns. We're also treated to being able to take part in study trips that go to different cities, hosted by different cities or different museums. We've gone to Kanazawa, to Nara, to Kyushu, Kyoto, and also just stayed in the Tokyo area. But really given access, unprecedented access to different sites and collections, and it allows specialists to talk to us in detail about the kind of work that they do. And finally, there are object handling sessions. You would think that curators would be well equipped to handle objects of all sorts, except that many of us in Western museums are trained in one particular field. When we come to our museums, we have to handle everything. And so there are sessions for instance, on handling swords, on handling textiles, types of objects that are generally not taught at graduate school, nor ones that there are specialists in museums already, collection specialists who are equipped to handle these types of objects. We also found that it was important that to support not only specialists of Japanese art, but to create allies in fields other than specifically traditional Japanese art history. The Japan Foundation, before the Arts Dialogue Committee had even been convened, had begun an exchange, a very effective curatorial exchange with curators from the United States and Japan. But the American curators were not specialists in Japanese art. They were generally specialists in contemporary art. And the 10-day program that was held over several years has brought together over 90 curators. And some of the collaborations, curators have gotten to know each other from Japan and the United States quite well. They've decided to collaborate and have done projects such as the 2013 exhibition at the Mori Art Museum on disaster, as well as an exhibition that took place at the Getty Art Museum of photographer Ishiuchi Miyako. Again, this kind of access has given American curators colleagues in Japan with whom they can regularly communicate, develop relationships with, and has also transformed the way that their own institutions think about Japanese art. We've also made sure that there have been public programs, so public symposia that continue to engage the general audiences. For it's important for the health of our field that it's not just being specialists looking to each other, but that we're very aware of the needs of our community. And so in 2013, there was a public symposium held at the Otsuka Museum in Naruto, examining the need for community-based arts programs, digitalization, and fundraising. We've also had sessions in 2015 about trends in contemporary art that was held at the Freer Sackler. And in 2016, we looked at art in the 20th after how art is the world in Japan after the year 2000 at the Kyushu National Museum. The most public of these large conventions bringing people together was the session of the International Council of Museums that was held from September 1st to the 7th in 2019 in Kyoto. The Japanese Organizing Committee hosted over 4,000 people. It was a phenomenal celebration of the arts, with keynote speeches from famous artists such as Saigo Jiang, architect Kuma Kengo, but specialists from around the world. But one of the agendas for this particular meeting for the Kyoto Organizing Committee was that the focus of ICOM, although it is said to be an international council of museums, has really been extremely Eurocentric. And everyone feels though it's very important in this day and age that museums address the arts of Asia, not only Asian art in Asia, but collections of Asian art throughout the world. And therefore there was a plenary session that was held on that particular topic. And there was a presentation on the activities of the Arts Dialogue Committee. One of the things that's important too is that if we want to create new audiences and we want to create younger audiences, we also had to be very active in social media. And so on the US side, with the coming of the Olympics, we felt as though it was an opportunity to reach out not only to the East Coast and to the West Coast, which have always been very excited by Japanese culture, but also to other areas of the United States, so that media campaign, a social media campaign called Arts Japan 2020, which was underwritten by the Japan-US Friendship Commission. And it was active on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And you can see on the left-hand side a program that was announcing a sculptural installation in Arizona, and also playing to younger people's interest in movies, an upcoming movie starring the late Chadwick Boseman on the story of Yasuke, a foreign samurai during the time of Oda Nobunaga. It meant that we've had widespread interest, people who have not known about all of these opportunities, and it also has just generated interest in topics that were not traditional topics that one would normally encounter in a museum, focusing on galleries and other places, community centers, very widespread covering of the arts of Japan, and I think has brought a new sense of excitement to what the arts of Japan has to offer. The work of our committee came to an end this year, and we, in this assessment of the program of the Arts Dialogue Committee, we looked again to see how effective it had been in bringing in this new generation. And we were extremely pleased to find that we had stemmed the diminishing numbers of Japanese art specialists. In fact, during this period, there have been six new positions that were created. 12 specialists had been hired during this period. Although the average age of specialists is still somewhat high because those people in the 60s and 70s just don't want to give up. They love what they do. But it does, the median age certainly does support the fact that a new generation of curators has entered museums in the United States. During the Tokyo National Museum curatorial exchange, I was happened to be on the Shinkansen. We were going between on the way to Kyoto, and we were talking about some of the programs that were going on, and a group of curators who were in their late 30s, early 40s, started talking excitedly among themselves. And one of them announced, "It's our age, it's our time, we're in here." And then they turned and they saw me. And then then there were the apologies, and I said, "Really, there's no reason to apologize. You have just announced what I've been waiting to hear, that there is this awareness of a new generation of curators of Japanese art and that they feel empowered is probably the most exciting thing I could have heard." The Arts Dialogue Committee has really given a good foundation for this new generation, but since the closure of the Tokyo National Museum curatorial exchange and on my returning back to Boston, the world has changed remarkably. Post 2020, the arts have just been devastated by the effects of the pandemic. And it is feared in the United States that over one third of American art museums will close. So there are fears that even in museums, large museums, what type of funding will there be for Japanese art programs? Will there be funding for staff? And will people be willing to look at Japanese art when galleries are somewhat limited? Certainly there are challenges ahead, but I think that one of the last programs that one of the last initiatives of the Arts Dialogue Committee provides a good promise, which is INJA, which is an international network for Japanese art that was launched in 2016. It was originally hosted by the Minneapolis Institute of Art, and it provides a directory of specialists for those who are registered, provides information on collections, resources, and exhibitions. At a time right now when we are trying to develop exhibitions through Zoom, curators like me are, not in the museums, we're working from home. It still has allowed, Zoom has allowed us to collaborate with colleagues through Zoom about future exhibitions we hope that will be realized in person. But it's also meant that the public, who has been unable to visit museums, has really been intrigued, a lot of them. There have been a lot of programs in the United States about Japanese art through digital means. And I think that this international network of Japanese art is now particularly timely. It is one thing that can provide a framework for us in how to collaborate digitally in a time when we cannot meet physically. And even once we do become able to travel again, this type of digital presentation is going to be increasingly important. And this framework can provide us with the context. Through sharing of information, we can share content, and we can work on together and collaborate. So the work of the ADC is formally completed, but our work is still very much, the work still waits us, and it provides future challenges. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Anne, and thank you very much for your wonderful, very comprehensive presentation. The history of ADC and how much you have achieved, and you also talked about the future expectation for the digital media arts, and so forth. But one of the things that you have also mentioned about the you know, warm memory of the Joes, you know, in a snowstorm in Boston and New York. But then the one of the other things, and very particularly a wonderful achievement of Joes was you know, that was led by Professor Yukio Lipit, who is one of the first cohort of the, you know, the Joes participants. So, you know, passing the torch on to, from the, you know, senior generation to the younger generation, but it is already achieved by the, you know, someone who is still young, but he is trying to pass in the torch on to the more younger people. So it's a wonderful achievement. And thank you very much for your hard work.
Yeah. Well, we're also having another, I was just informed this week that the Tokyo National Museum will have a curatorial exchange. But this one is, this fall is, and this winter is going to happen digitally again. And so,
okay. So we have the question from Christian Yano, who is the chair of the AAS in Asia this year, I think. And she's asking, you know, thank you for a wonderful and exciting presentation. What kind of space is there for visual arts by Japanese Americans?
Well, this is something that actually is been very much part of discussion, and I think it is a topic that is now being addressed by the American Museum Curators of Asian Art. It's something that not many of us are trained to do, but it's something that all of us are learning about. And certainly some museums, as we try to diversify our audiences, have really looked into this topic. The Asian Art Museum of San Francisco, for instance, is very committed to collecting works by Asian American artists. And it is something that at my museum, we are very much now in discussion about. It may not necessarily rest with the Department of Japanese Art. It might represent a collaboration, for instance, between a specialist in Japanese art and a specialist in modern and contemporary art. Because none of us are specifically trained to do that, but it is something that all museums do feel is of great need, and one makes sure that people feel represented in the institutions where we work.
I see. Well, I suppose that Professor Yano's question is specifically about the, you know, visual arts by Japanese Americans.
Yes. Yeah. Well, Japanese American artists, I mean, I don't know, those of you in Japan know that, for instance, this month there was the debut of the stamps by with Ruth Asawa's works of art. I went out and promptly bought many of these stamps, commemorative stamps that have come out. But Japanese American artists, I mean, have been some of the most established Asian American artists, certainly. But it's also a very tricky question. And it's something that we were all discussing as to, when does an artist become a Japanese American artist? When is an artist a Japanese artist working in the United States? I mean, there are many, many different things that we all are in the process of evaluating. But I think collaboration is probably the key to it.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much. And we still have another couple of other questions, but our time is a blessing, so I think we have to close and for this ADC report. And thank you very much, Dr. Nishimura Mosta, for your long serving and dedication for the Japanese arts in the United States. Thank you. So we would like to move on to Dr. Masako Egawa for our ERC report, Educational Review Committee's report. So she co-chaired this ERC for the past several years. Thank you very much, Dr. Egawa.
Thank you, Ito-san, for the kind introduction. And good morning and good evening. I co-chair ERC with the Professor Len Chopa of University of Virginia. And today, I'm very happy to have this opportunity to make presentation on our activities. Okay. By way of background, about 8 years ago, CALCO members became concerned about the decline in the number of Japanese students studying in the United States and formed the Educational Task Force. The task force published a report in 2013, which recommended doubling the number of US and Japanese students studying in each other's country by 2020. The photo on the left was taken when the task force submitted the report to Prime Minister Abe in June 2013. Then the Educational Exchange Review Committee, or ERC, was formed to monitor and report on the progress toward that goal. Before I discuss the number of students and whether we achieve the targets, I'd like to touch on the important qualitative aspects of the student mobility. In recent years, we have observed a paradigm shift or large societal change, including the permeation of information communication technology, accelerating globalization, rise of China, increasing economic disparity and populism across the world. Inevitably, those developments influence student mobility. First, both universities and students have embraced the value of international experiences. Many universities began offering various programs for international experiences for their students in order to nurture the global citizens. As a result, students today have more diverse alternatives, including short-term programs. Also, the behavior and expectations of those students have changed. Unlike the time when some of you studied overseas during 80s and 90s, going abroad is no longer an adventure, and students today expect more guidance and handholding. They are always connected with their friends and family members through the internet when they are abroad. Overall, however, I'm pleased to report that student mobility between the United States and Japan has steadily increased during the review period starting 2012. Seeds have been sown thanks to the efforts of all the parties in both countries. Now let's look at the student mobility numbers from the open doors. As you can see from this, the declining trend of the number of the Japanese students studying in the US has stabilized. We should also keep in mind that young Japanese population of 20s and 30s have declined by almost 24% since 2010. In contrast, the number of American students studying in Japan showed healthy growth. Let's look at the breakdown of student mobility. For monitoring the student mobility numbers, we use the open door data from the Institute of Education in the United States and the data from Japan Student Services Organization, or JASO. Those two institutions collect data based on different standards. So please bear in mind that their numbers do not match. Starting from the left bar, the number of Japanese students studying in the US for academic credit grew by 65%. From 2012 through 2019. They include those students spending a semester or full academic year at US universities based on student exchange agreements, and those students participating in short-term programs such as summer schools, intensive language training, or faculty-led programs. The bar on the right-hand side shows the students participating in short-term programs without academic credit. And the numbers almost tripled or grew by 178%. The bar in the middle represents those students studying for a year or more based on partnership agreements between universities, according to JASO. Since most exchange students based on partnership agreements spend less than 12 months, the numbers are small, but grew by 95%. Recently, an increasing number of Japanese high school graduates applied to US universities rather than going to Japanese universities. Also, many Japanese college graduates pursue master or PhD degrees at US institutions. Those students are included in the open doors data, on the previous page, but not included in those parts on this page based on JASO data. JASO collects the information about the students currently enrolled at Japanese universities. Now let's look at the US students studying in Japan. Looking at the bar on the left, the number of American students studying in Japan for academic credit increased by 60% from 2012 through 2019. Bar on the right-hand side shows the number of students participating in short-term programs, which grew much faster and increased by 407% from 2013 through 2018. When ERC began, we spent a lot of time finding out the reasons why Japanese students do not study abroad. Through various surveys and research, we found that the biggest reasons are lack of financial resources and insufficient English language skills. Therefore, the government and universities in Japan and US launched various initiatives to address those problems. First, I will explain initiatives to support Japanese students studying in the US. Tobitate Ryugaku Japan is a scholarship program based on public-private partnership starting in 2013. As of January 2020, 246 firms have donated approximately 12 billion yen to this initiative. By last year, 8,000 students received those scholarships. And we estimate a good number of those students went to study at US universities. Many parties in Japan and US began to offer scholarships to encourage student mobility. Tomodachi Initiative, which was launched after 3/11 earthquake and tsunami, is one of the successful examples. To improve the English language skills of Japanese students, Japan's Ministry of Education has undertaken English language education reform at elementary, junior, and senior high schools, focusing on four skills: speaking, listening, reading, and writing, with reference to the Common European Framework of Reference for Languages. US government initiated Team Up campaign to promote partnerships between smaller regional universities in US and Japan. Collaborative Online International Learning is a virtual exchange program utilizing video conferencing and other online tools to promote international study. Now, I'd like to discuss the initiative to support US students studying in Japan. In 2014, Japan's Ministry of Education revised articles of standard for establishment of universities to allow Japanese universities to confer joint degree with the partner universities. In 2017, the first joint program was launched between Ritsumeika University in Japan and American University in Washington, D.C., which became very popular among the American students. Japanese universities are increasing the number of classes and courses taught in foreign languages, mostly in English. The number of such courses at universities participating in top global university project almost doubled from 2014 to 2018, with the aim of increasing them to over 55,000 by 2023. Okinawa Institute of Science and Technology Graduate Study was established in 2011 as an experimental higher education institution funded by the Japanese government. The official language is English, and the majority of the academic staff and students are non-Japanese, including many Americans. Internships are very popular among US college students. The American Chamber of Commerce Japan, Japan-US Friendship Commission, among others, successfully implemented internship programs for American students to spend time in Japan. Promoting Japanese language education in the US is important to encourage more American students to study in Japan. According to the Japan Foundation survey, during the recent 3 years, number of institutions learners of Japanese language decreased while the number of teachers increased. Among those teachers in the US, 77% are native Japanese speakers. According to Modern Language Association, the number of foreign language learners decreased from 2013 to 2016, but the learners of Japanese and Korean languages increased. I hear that the Japanese language classes are popular among US college students because young Americans like Japanese games, manga, and anime. So we'd like to encourage more Americans to consider becoming Japanese language teachers. I'd like to address the challenges for further enhancing student mobility between US and Japan. First, we need to continue our efforts to make US-Japan study abroad attractive to students. Japan ranked number 8 in terms of number of students studying in the US, trailing Taiwan and Korea. Similarly, US ranked number 13 in 2019 in terms of the number of students studying in Japan, down from the 10th in 2015. So relatively speaking, both US and Japan are losing international students to other countries, and we should make US-Japan study abroad attractive to students. Another challenge is lack of financial resources. Academic institutions need to invest in infrastructure to accommodate international students. We also need to provide scholarships to students. In conclusion, student mobility between United States and Japan have increased steadily since 2012, thanks to the efforts of all the stakeholders in both countries. In particular, we have seen strong growth in short-term programs. It is important to encourage those students to engage in longer-term study in future, such as a year-long study abroad programs and degree-seeking programs. Although the seeds have been sown, we recognize that the challenge remains and the work is far from completed. We like to encourage that we should continue efforts to enhance student mobility between the US and Japan, to develop the next generation of the stewards of US-Japan collaboration and relationship. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Egawa, for your comprehensive explanation of ERC final report. And now I'd like to take some questions from the audience, but before that, and I would, you know, I understand that this ERC report doesn't cover any impact from this, you know, current COVID-19, you know, the pandemic around the world. So student mobility is severely hit by this pandemic. So if we had a time to touch upon this pandemic impact on ERC report, what would you like to add?
Well, it's very difficult to forecast what's going to happen because most of the universities in the US and Japan are still continuing online education. But actually online education offers opportunities to study from other countries, and also interaction is also possible. So even though it's very different from face-to-face interaction, all the universities and stakeholders are making efforts to make university experience and university education meaningful. And I really sincerely hope that we can continue to encourage our young generation to consider studying other countries and engage in international experiences. It's very difficult to foresee what's going to happen, but I'm cautiously optimistic.
Thank you very much. Okay, we have some questions. Well, you just touched upon that some other countries are increasing the numbers of the welcoming the, you know, the student mobility from international students, especially in the Asian countries. And if you know particular case, do you know any good examples by other Asian countries who have been succeeding in increasing the number? Or if maybe can we ask our audience? You know, I remember that Dr. Egawa wanted to know how the other Southeast Asian countries are doing with the academic calendar, for example. Because you know, one of the reasons that, we have been encouraged to improve among the Japanese systems in the academic campuses is academic calendar, wasn't it? So do you have any idea of how to learn from the, you know, the other good examples from the Asian countries, for example?
Are you asking me?
Yes, oh, yes.
Well, thank you. Actually, we did the University of Tokyo when I was executive vice president about 6 years ago, considered September enrollment, and which was not implemented. And during the pandemic, this September enrollment became discussions were debated, and but we did not go through. So we are, and it seems like during the past several years, many South Asian countries have changed the academic calendar to facilitate student mobility and academic exchange with majority of the institutions, because I think more than 70% of the universities around the world now start in late August or September, sometime in the fall. And so that's one of the ideas we actually discussed in ETF and ERC as well. But I'd like to hear from the audience about your own experiences, and especially in other Asian countries.
Yes, and as Dr. Egawa is encouraging the other audiences and on this panel, please write that, you know, what is the area, you know, the season of your academic calendar starts in your country, for example. We would be highly appreciated in your, you know, input to our study. Thank you very much. And in so far, I haven't seen any, you know, the response on that academic calendar on the chat page. But let's move on to another question. If Dr. Smith hasn't arrived yet, right? Okay. So maybe
Ito-san.
Okay.
Ito-san.
Yes.
Ito-san, can I just ask one question? Not yes, one question, please. But just because it was very fascinating. Dr. Egawa's presentation was very fascinating. Because I work at Osaka University. I've been doing internationalization, double degree programs. Mm-hmm. And one issue I felt particularly with the United States was that the very good Japanese universities, the national universities, are national universities, they're public. The very good ones in the United States are private. And I have felt hesitation on the part of particularly Osaka in not succeeding in double degree program agreements on the tuition. Mm-hmm. American universities will not concede. Whereas with Southeast Asia or with Korea, China, or Europe, there's a fee waiver. Mm-hmm. I was wondering if there was any effort by the Japanese government, perhaps as a trade issue, if this, I think this is a serious issue, because if the Americans won't negotiate, particularly with public universities, they will be overwhelmed by cash-rich Chinese international students, mm-hmm, to go to American, like Harvard, Yale, Stanford, mm-hmm, Berkeley. So I was wondering if there were any thoughts about that. Thank you.
This fee issue by American universities is something we discussed and touched upon a little bit in our final report. It has been a tradition in a student exchange agreements to waive fees irrespective of the difference in tuition between the universities. The joint degree programs are kind of new for Japanese universities, so I cannot address that. But for the traditional student exchange for a term a year, it has been waiving fees. And this is not just with the US universities, but the European universities, Asian universities around the world. And today, we continue to be able to do the similar arrangements with the universities in other countries, but probably because funding situation for the US universities are very acute. We are hearing that the many universities are sometimes asked to pay fees to compensate the difference in tuition. And it's a very difficult problem, but we hope that we can come up with the innovative solutions, perhaps try to raise funds to compensate those fees from either public or private sector. We just have to be creative and to overcome that, because I agree that it's a shame that the Japanese students choose to go to other countries, even though for economic reasons, even though they are actually interested in studying in the United States.
Thank you. Sorry.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, so thank you very much, Dr. Egawa, for your nice presentation, and it's very comprehensive. And I hope that it will help the other student mobility specialists around the world, especially in this AAS community. So now we have Dr. Sheila Smith with us online. And Dr. Smith was appointed as a U.S. chair of the CALCOM on this May the 1st. So congratulations, Dr. Sheila Smith. So Sheila Smith is a senior fellow for Japanese studies at the Council on Foreign Relations in Washington, D.C. And would you like to start with your comments or even greetings, maybe?
Thank you so much, Ito-san. I am delighted, and again, I apologize for coming in late to what I think was a fantastic conversation. So I'm sure that Anne Morris and Egawa-sensei carried it very, very well. But I am delighted to be here. It's good to see you, even if it's virtually. And I hope that at some point soon, we'll all be able to get in the room together to recognize that we're all still human beings and still able to have that kind of social interaction. I'm beginning to feel a little bit like an AI model or something. I don't know. It's kind of odd. But the great news is, and I say thank you for noting that I have been selected as chair. The great news for me is this kind of interaction is now much more accessible, much more available. And I think it's been great for me to see just how often my friends and colleagues in Tokyo have been able and willing to join us in conversation. So, you know, we have to make the best of the moment, and perhaps this new platform is not so bad after all. But I think, you know, as I think about CALCON, and I'm looking forward to discussing this more with Kubo-sensei in a few minutes, but, you know, from the United States, we are looking at people-to-people exchange is so much more important today as the world gets increasingly fraught, as people get increasingly worried about leaving their own countries. I think all of the trends that I'm sure that Egawa-san was talking about in terms of student mobility are exacerbated, I think, by the COVID experience. I know that my son is becoming much more anxious about leaving the United States and traveling. And so we're going to have to work a little bit harder, those of us who are in this world of people-to-people exchange, to take advantage of these new platforms, but also make sure that our traditional way of building networks and building the friendships and the collaboration that we often see across the board between Americans and Japanese through many of these programs, that it continues and people continue to invest in it. So it's a very important moment, I think, for CALCON, not to let down its guard, but to maybe up its game just a little bit, to be flexible, but to also recognize that it is these long, lifelong relationships that we all build professionally, personally, that really carry the relationship and support our two governments. So I can't think of a more important time for us to be working together. So Ito-san, thank you, as always, for all the work that you do to make sure that we have these opportunities.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Smith. And you know, just before you enter to join us, Professor Kubo made a very wonderful presentation about the history of Kalkon. Mm-hmm. So you just touched upon the, you know, how it started. So Dr. Kubo and Dr. Smith, maybe you can start your conversation or dialogue about the, you know, the Kalkon and how U.S.-Japan relations in terms of cultural and educational interchanges. On top of that, the intellectual you know, exchanges will you know, happening in the future. And especially I reckon that both of you co-chair that, you know, our Kalkon Next Generation Task Force. So please start your conversation, you know, as the time allows, you know, maybe we can do that for another 10 minutes or so.
Great.
Thank you.
So I can't see Kubo Sensei, so he must be there somewhere.
Yes.
I can hear him. I can hear him.
Congratulations for your new appointment as the chair on the U.S. Kalkon. So, you know, I'd like to ask you, what do you think, what you think are the challenges and the tasks for Kalkon for the coming years, you know, as the U.S. chair?
No, thank you. Oh dear. Well, so, you know, I'm sorry I missed your presentation on the history, because I so love the beginning of this initiative was attached, of course, to the UMPO, you know, yep, discord between our two countries and the recognition that the governments couldn't do it alone, right? That the people of both countries needed to support the relationship. And in fact, every time that we go to the State Department to consult with them, the diplomats are saying, we can't do this without you. We must have this component and support. And so it's a very valuable piece of American foreign policy, American thinking about the future of the relationship. But you know, when you and I worked on that Next Generation Task Force, what I was really amazed by was how much and how broad our relationship has become. So how much opportunity there is to work over a whole array, whether it's space or biotech or cybersecurity or energy policy, all kinds of things that I think probably you and I, when we were a little younger, wouldn't have imagined as being part of the US-Japan relationship, right? Bless you. But you know, but if you're a young person today coming up in the and wanting to have a career that involves the United States, if you're Japanese, or involves Japan, if you're American, you've got a whole host of opportunities to build that career. It's not just going into government and, you know, supporting the UMPO, or it's going into business and supporting trade. There's such a creative array of opportunity for our younger generations. And I think that's a really positive statement about the strength of our bilateral partnership.
Okay, yeah, thanks. You know, some important things are happening now in Japan, the Japanese politics. You must be very busy now. I'm not asking what our next prime minister, who the next prime minister is, but, you know, what do you think of the entire term of the Abe administration, especially in the context of how the U.S. Scholars, commentators, journalists characterized the Prime Minister Abe? At first, you know, he was sometimes, you know, defined as a very dangerous, a super ultra nationalist. But at the same time, you know, he made the cost of childcare or kindergarten free, you know, which would be probably unthinkable in U.S. politics, you know, if Sanders wouldn't, you know, realize that. So, you know, and this is, you know, one example of how the kind of U.S. culture, intellectuals, you know, view, you know, Japanese politics, politicians, you know. And also there might be some differences between the U.S. academia and the think tank people in, you know, defining Japanese politics. So, Mr. Abe might be just the example or illustration of the difference, you know. What is your observation, given Mr. Abe is now retiring?
So, you know, I think a lot of us were you know, 2020 was supposed to be Mr. Abe's year in a way, right? It was the culmination of many of the things that he had worked towards, the economy, the turning the Japanese economy around and moving towards more positive growth, the Tokyo Olympics. I mean, I am not the only one, I'm sure, who loved to see him as Super Mario appear in Rio. So he had a sense of humor about, you know, the way in which this Olympic vision was going to portray Japan. And I think he was very much looking forward to all of the technological advances and all the kinds of things that Japan could showcase about itself on that stage. And then, of course, I think we all expected us kind of politics nerds, all expected somewhere around the end of 2020, there might be a succession and election setup that would allow him to exit with great pride. And of course, COVID-19 destroyed all of that, right? He may be the first serious political leader around the globe who really suffers from the impact of the COVID pandemic. And I think it's a shame to watch that happen. I think the almost eight years he was in office, I think were very productive for Japan. And as you said, it was always interesting for me to talk to Japanese friends, left or right, center, whatever their political persuasion was. And their evaluation of Abe was really about the domestic side of things. And the idea that a prime minister could come along and make Japanese feel more optimistic about their future. And I think we underestimate the importance that was for many, many Japanese, again, regardless of political persuasion. Not everybody agreed with all his policies and not everybody thought that he was always right. And of course, that's true of any political leader. But I think that was an impressive accomplishment if you look at the domestic side. As you said, there was a lot done and there's more to be done. But still, I think he managed to turn that big ship that is Japan in a direction that it was pretty impressive to watch. He didn't do it alone. He did it with his party. He had his two-thirds majority in the lower house, which is a gift for anybody in a parliamentary system. So, but I think it's important. On the global stage, you've seen, right, in the last few days, how many leaders around the world have praised him. And I think he really came in, he was very good during the Obama years, I'm not criticizing that, but he really came into his own on the global stage when we started to go a little helter-skelter with Mr. Trump, and I'll be quite honest about it, right? So whether it was shepherding the TPP to the CTPP, right? Whether it was the trade agreement with the EU, whether it was getting all of the UN Security Councils engaged in North Korea, sanctioning a whole host of issues, the digital future of digital management at Osaka G20. He was very active and very constructive in the multilateral setting, and especially given his ability to navigate with and around our sort of unpredictable president. So I think there's a lot of ways in which he has left a very high set of expectations for the next person who's going to come into that office. Because you have to reach high, I think, to get that kind of accomplishment as Prime Minister of Japan.
Yeah, okay, good. I'd like to ask you one more question. We are doing this meeting online, and of course, there are many sad things happening in this pandemic, but we found that we could do many things, you know, online, and in terms of the U.S.-Japan cultural educational exchanges, I think, we never thought about this, but there could be a vast opportunity for like a grassroots interchange, the educational exchanges, or even intellectual exchanges. So, there might be it might be a good idea for us to, look at fresh look at what we could do, in terms of the curriculum, the outreach, with a fresh eye, what do you think,
No, I think, and again, you and I, in our two task forces, the Next Generation Task Force talked about this, about the importance of networks between and creating those networks for those really good relationships, person to person, but also the opportunity for new platforms, to think about new platforms, not only for people like us to have conversations, but also for students to share classroom experience and the you know, to build on the MEXTAS COIL program, and to allow our study abroad students who can't go abroad right now, our Americans are stuck at home, but they are also reaching out to others in Japan and Japanese universities to be able to continue those relationships regardless. So I think this opens the door to a lot of possibilities. I don't think it replaces that person-to-person element, but certainly strengthens the ability to continue to be in touch and to continue to get people who may not be able to travel, either because of their work or because of whatever circumstance, they can still be part of the dialogue, the people-to-people exchange between the United States and Japan. The other thing, Kubo-sensei, if you don't mind, it also lets me see your study. I think what's so fun about this, Egawa-san's up there, I'm trying to look at her bookcase to see what she's got behind her. I mean, I think it also gives us a little bit more familiarity, right? It's been interesting to me to do Zoom meetings with people that I would normally see in a room, an office with a suit, and now I get to see them relaxed and at home. And it's just really fun for me because I think it's the way we should think about this relationship, again, in personal terms as much as in professional terms.
But yeah.
I'll introduce you to my dog if you'd like. No. But I think it's created a kind of intimacy for people who genuinely want the interaction with each other. And I think that's the point I'm making. It's not just because we must have, you know, Nichibe Koryu. It's because we actually genuinely care about each other and what's happening. And I think this is a big part of the strength of our relationship. Is it's not just because we have to do it, it's because we're all genuinely committed to doing it.
Okay.
So thank you very much. And then sometimes I feel, you know, Zoom is such a very convenient media, but then at the same time, you know, if we are talking in this way, you know, because you know, both Dr. Kubo and Dr. Smith and Ann and Ega-sensei, everyone knows each other. So we can, you know, start talking very casually on this platform. But what about the other scholars from, you know, the country whom we have never visited before, and it's, I presume it's a little bit difficult for us to start, you know, the you know, very candid exchange of opinions. So I'm not complaining about this COVID situation, but you know, I really wish you know, people to people real exchange will start, you know, the resuming soon. But then with the new normal, so what do you expect the new normal, you know, with living with the COVID-19 in terms of the intellectual exchanges? When we talk about the new platform, what is exactly this new platform, for example? Dr. Smith?
You wanted to go first? Or?
Yes, okay.
So I'll share a couple of thoughts and then Kubo-sensei can add his thoughts. I think, I don't think we know the new normal yet. And of course, this all depends on, you know, our medical scientists are all saying it's a couple of years, or some people are saying it's a decade. It's going to be like the cold. It's going to be with us forever. But I think we will adapt to whatever this pandemic has brought to us. How soon I'll be able to get on an airplane and go to Tokyo, I can't predict at this point, quite honestly. But I think that's true of everybody. But I do think that, I think people understand that they can't live in a vacuum. And I think the same people who would get on a plane and fly to Tokyo to meet their colleagues in Tokyo to solve a problem will want to do it via Zoom. You know what I mean? It's not the perfect, it's not the best. But I do think it opens up some interesting thinking about teaching, about scholarly exchange, about ways in which perhaps we could even get people who don't normally visit with each other to get more comfortable in this setting, and that will involve translation and things like that. But I do think it's possible, and I'm not saying that this should replace the people to people, but I think we'll have to adapt to whatever the world is evolving towards. The one thing I worry about is that we will lose interest in getting on the airplane and going. Because this will become easy. You can stay at home. You don't have to pack your suitcase. But I hope that's not the case, because I think this is supplemental. It's, as you said, it's not the creation of the relationship, but it's the sustenance of the communication that this is, this platform works for.
Yeah, I'm kind of optimistic that we could, perhaps overcome this pandemic with new vaccine and a new medicine in a few years, and we might be able to get back to kind of normalcy. And we will confront some negative legacies as well as positive legacies. And as I said, there are vast potentialities for online communication and online exchanges of ideas. So, you know, we need to look for that. But I agree with Sheila, you said a very important thing that, you know, online communication is not a perfect substitute for the on-site real, you know, the interchange, you know, real, you know, conference, real exchange of ideas. So then, you know, increasingly, we need to put more financial resources for real meeting, you know, because, you know, it's so easy to do this online. So, you know, I think this is something we need to be very, you know, careful about in the future.
Right. I agree.
Okay. So to close, maybe we have another very short, brief question from, I will be combining two questions from the audiences. One is from my younger colleague from Calgary, and she's wondering what areas and topics should be discussed after ADC and ERC. And another question comes from Kathleen Mezzo, and she's wondering what can Calgon do to engage with social change and social justice, or, you know, the women's issue, or immigrant injustice within and between our countries. So what do you expect in the next topics after ELC and ADC? Maybe in 1 minute each?
For the second question, I think, you know, these diversity issues, immigration issue, gender issues are brought to our attention kind of constantly by US part of the CARICOM. And we are trying to learn from that, but we are also to try to be very attentive to the importance of that issue. And some of them, or actually all of them, are important issues in Japan too. So, I'm not sure how we could deal with that. Could we, you know, form, should we form a kind of a ad hoc meeting? I don't know. We should do something, you know, more. What was the first question?
The first question is closely related to the second question. Yes, so what next after ELC and ADC?
But also, probably, the relation between cultural exchanges or cultural understanding and security environment are getting tighter because Japan faces a more kind of severe international security environment. And so, this is a touchy issue, but I think security and cultural exchanges are probably in our mind on Japan side, a little bit more tightly, intertwined. This is a challenge for CARICOM, how to deal with the security part. And this is not what we are supposed to, deal with. But I think, this there's a shadow, over us, from this perspective.
Thank you very much. Now, what about Dr. Smith?
So I think we've got some conversations to have among ourselves on each side, but also between ourselves on what we might want to organize a task force or a working group around. And I think there's a lot of interesting thought processes going on both in Tokyo and in Washington. So I think we'll continue to have that conversation. I don't want to say this issue or that issue because I'm not sure yet where we would both mutually find benefit. So I think we should do it. I think for Catherine's question, I think it's obviously important for the United States and in the commissioners on the US Culcon panel to think very carefully about the moment we are in our social call for social justice. And so we have very consciously begun to think about ways in which we ought to respond. And we are also in the Japan-US Friendship Commission making that a priority to think through carefully, not just to make statements, but to think through carefully where our work would contribute to the moment that I think every American is being called upon to recognize in our country. On the environmental issues, women issues, and if you bracket it out a little bit on some of these issues, one of the areas where we are also thinking, and this is a conversation with Kubo-san and I have also had about American studies in Japan and Japanese studies in the United States, is the old traditional way of organizing area studies has changed in our university campuses. Mm-hmm. Younger students in the United States want to think about environmental issues. And so we were trying to think about ways perhaps we can build Japanese experience into thinking about a curriculum about global environmentalism, right? Mm-hmm. Or Japanese experience into a curriculum about gender equality and women's issues. So there are new ways we may have to be creative about thinking about how do you teach about America in Japan, for example, not in the old fashioned way of you must go to the United States, we must be an American studies specialist, but how do we think about these issues, American experience that can be taught in Japanese curricula, right? That would be a positive contribution to having younger Japanese understand America and American experience differently. So these are big picture questions. We can't do it alone in Culcon. Obviously, mm-hmm, we have mm-hmm. to reach out to educators across the board, and especially that next generation of Japan specialists is where I think our commissioners are looking for some guidance. So we are working on it, and we will engage as much as we can with people like you who are teaching at the moment.
Okay, thank you very much. And we have already exceeded our limited time allocation, but thank you very much. And you know, after I studied this 60 years of history of Culcon, I found that some moments, you know, from time to time that we needed, that some parts comes from the US side and some parts comes from the Japan side. We need to talk also about the security issues. So I found that, you know, right now the Dr. Smith and the chair of the US Culcon is an expertise in security issues, and we have Kubo-sensei, and our Japan chair is Ambassador Ryozo Kato, who is also expertise in national security. But anyway, we will explore what we can do after this ELC and ADC. And thank you very much for your time and sharing the all your achievements. And from ADC, Dr. Ann Nishimura-Morse, once again, thank you very much. And Dr. Egawa, thank you very much for your ELC report. And so that's, I think we all finished. And Haruko,
yes,
can I pass the microphone to you?
Yes. Thank you very much. Thank you very much to the panel. This panel, this room will be closed from 9:45 to move on to the parallel sessions, and it will not open until 6:30. But to others, particularly for the panel today, and maybe Egawa-sensei and Sheila, there's a tomorrow we have a late breaking news panel on transnational student mobility, and we will be doing this with India. So India and the Rohingya people, and also with Singapore. So I hope this might be a bit of an information. This will also be in the parallel session. So thank you again, Ito-san. And so I will now close the session, this room, and hope to see you later. Thank you. We'll be right back.